Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and while we have had many, many discussions already regarding the urinary system, this video we will be discussing the more distal portions of this system, so the urinary system as associated with the pelvis. And so there are three main areas we will be discussing: the pelvic portion of the ureters, the urinary bladder, and the urethra. So let's start with the ureters, as I hope these structures are already quite familiar to you, as we did discuss them in some detail during the renal section. And as you know, the ureters are two muscular tubes that will allow the transport of urine from the kidneys, as it is continuous with the renal pelvis, to the urinary bladder. And they are approximately 25 to 30 centimeters in length, and there are three major parts. We have already explored this first part, which is the abdominal part. It descends anterior to the psoas major muscle, and this will transition to the pelvic part after it crosses over that bifurcation of the common iliac arteries to enter the pelvic cavity. The pelvic part, as its name would suggest, is in the pelvic cavity. And as this is a relatively complex and crowded area, it has close geographical relationships with many structures, but of most clinical importance, it is very closely related to the uterine artery on its course to the bladder. So you can see that here near the uterine cervix. It also has a close relationship to the ductus deferens and the seminal vesicles, which would be located near the base of the bladder. The last portion of the ureter is where it actually runs within the wall of the urinary bladder at its base, and this is referred to as the intramural part, and this is actually the narrowest part of the ureter. All right, so now let's move to the urinary bladder, which is located in the anterior portion of the pelvic cavity. Its size and its shape will vary dependent on the amount of urine present, as well as the state of any neighboring viscera. So there's a lot of movement and a lot of change that can occur in the bladder. When the bladder is empty, it lies completely within the lesser pelvis, but it can extend into the abdominal cavity as it expands. There are numerous surfaces and parts of the bladder, but we're going to focus on these three, starting with the apex. The apex of the bladder always faces towards the pubic symphysis, and it will be superior posterior to the pubic symphysis. So you can kind of see it kind of right here. Here is the pubic symphysis. Recall that's that cartilaginous joint on the anterior portion of the pelvic girdle. Recall that the median, not the medial, the median umbilical fold, which is formed by peritoneum covering the medial umbilical ligament. And that median umbilical ligament is a remnant of the urachus, which connects the apex of the bladder to the umbilicus. All right, the base, or sometimes you hear it referred to as the fundus of the bladder, is its posteriormost wall. And it is here that those intramural parts of the ureters will enter into the bladder. So that's going to be more towards this portion here. Lastly, the neck of the bladder is inferiorly placed, and it is almost completely fixed, meaning that there should be very little movement or change in shape of this portion of the bladder, unless there is a change in the muscle or the ligaments around this area, which can affect urinary continence. It is very closely geographically related to the vagina or the prostate. Now, speaking of the internal bladder, there is a grossly visible trigon, which is outlined by the two slit-like ureteric orifices and the internal urethral meatus, which is in this general region here. And you can see that this forms a trigon or a triangular shape. In individuals past middle age with a prostate, there may be an elevation immediately kind of behind the internal urethral meatus, so this general region right here, And this is caused by what is often termed the median prostatic lobe. If this area increases in size, this can affect the flow of urine in this area. Lastly, let's discuss the urethra, which is sexually polymorphic area. We will be discussing two of the most common organizations of the urethra, with the first being the organization of the urethra in individuals assigned female at birth. In adults, this urethra is typically about 4 centimeters long. So I'm going to kind of outline this area here. And will extend from the internal urethral meatus to the external urethral meatus. That makes sense. Those names make sense. With the in-between length traveling anterior-inferiorly and kind of intermediate to the pubic symphysis and the vagina. So it'll be kind of intermediate in placement there. And as mentioned, it will terminate in the external urethral meatus, which is located in the vestibule of the vagina, which is often just referred to as the vestibule. And in the vestibule, the external urethral meatus is located around 2.5 centimeters posterior to the gland's clitoris and anterior to the opening of the vagina. All right, so you can see that. Right here, here's the opening of the vagina or the vaginal opening. The urethra of individuals typically assigned male at birth is comparatively longer at about 18 to 20 centimeters long, but again, extending from the internal urethral meatus to the external urethral meatus. There are 3 major parts of the urethra for these individuals, with a 4th part sometimes mentioned, the pre-prostatic part, which is the very short portion that extends from the base of the bladder to the prostate. The prostatic part will extend through the prostate, as its name would suggest, so you can see that right here. And it is at the prostatic urethra that the contents of the ejaculatory ducts and the prostatic ducts will enter the urethral system. The membranous part or membranous portion of the urethra will traverse the pelvic diaphragm, which is right here. So it's a short area right in that region. And this will lead into the spongy or penile portion of the urethra. And this is going to start at the bulb of the penis, and which we know the bulb is composed of corpus spongiosum, erectile tissue, and it will extend through the corpus spongiosum of the body of the penis to the distal portion of the gland's penis, where the urethra ends at the external urethral meatus. So you can kind of follow this here in an illustration as well through the length of that corpus spongiosum. All right, excellent job. We have made it to the summary slide. Please take your time to review and relate the information that we have learned during the renal portion of your curriculum. As always, please, please feel free to reach out to me or any of my anatomy colleagues with any questions. And have a great rest of your day.